It's once again time for a video game that has been collecting dust on my digital cells unplayed for many years before finally getting reviewed on this show. However, The Last Remnant is timelier than most because it received remastered edition just at the end of last year, which was around the same time as its PC version was removed from Steam's digital stores after being there for nearly a decade. So yeah, I'll be reviewing the theatrical version instead of the final cut, but let's see how well this 2008 role-playing strategy hybrid has stood the test of time. This is also one of those games where it's hard to point out who the main creative forces are. There is the director Hiroshi Takai, who is one of the directors of Final Fantasy XIV and has done graphics for Saga franchise, but instead of writing credits there are planners, whatever that practically means. I shall then highlight the ones credited as lead planners: Kazuhiro Kataoka of Ogre Battle 64, Person of Lordly Caliber, and Persona 2 Eternal Punishment, Kazutoyo Maehiro of Final Fantasy Tactics and Vagrant Story, and Masato Yagi of Final Fantasy Crystal Chronicles and Dragon Quest XI Echoes of an Elusive Age. Also, I used English dub because this is my first playthrough attempt, but let me know if you prefer to hear the original audio from now on. Well, the reception for this game is about 50-50 split, and it's declared either as underappreciated unique experiment or an unnecessarily convoluted mess, but there has to be some reason for its cult status.
In the world of I Don't Remember the Name, Johnny Young Bosk stars as Russ Sykes, a young bright lad who is doing one of his favorite pastimes, rushing blindly into danger. Yeah, he does this stuff for the majority of the first half and his act now as questions never satisfy and his lack of tact gets a bit much at times.
To be fair, I've seen worst brats as protagonist. And hidden deep under all that layer of immaturity is a standout guy who cares for his friends and family, so at least his heart is cold.
Speaking of which, Russ is in search for his sister Irina, played by Erika Lenhardt, who he has been taking care of since their parents went to work on the Wolf's Magic Academy secret projects, as she was kidnapped by mysterious creepy dudes. He coincidentally runs into city-state's Athlum's young leader David Nassau, played by Jason Lee Brecht, and his four generals whose names don't matter because they don't have distinct personalities. Well, except Emma Honeywell, played by Susan Durden, a no-nonsense lady who tends to put Russ in his place, yet is compassionate when needed. Anyway, the story... Oh, yeah, that texture pumping. Get used to it because it happened in every single scene's transition. I don't usually mind graphical crudeness, but this is distracting.
One of the reasons for this game's existence was to work as a developer testing ground for Unreal 3 engine because they wanted to reduce the production cost by purchasing a pre-made engine. It is evident that they're not familiar with all of its quirks, but apparently it's still better than the original Xbox 360 release, and apparently the remastered version has a remove the rest of the beauty scratches. Overall, the OG PC version looks like generic late 2000s goodness, notwithstanding the overexpressive motion capture stuff. Anyway!
The story is centered on remnants that are powerful magic tools left by some higher power or something, and the villains want to use Irina's hidden powers to activate them for sinister purposes. Even though this creepy rope dude is husky voice and speaks in bad guy intonations, he's not, however, the main villain of the piece.
And neither is this clown, though he really, really wants to be one. Now that is a villain worthy of respect.
Christopher Sabat plays as the near indestructible force of nature known as the Conqueror, who goes waging war all around the world, pounding remnants into himself. Nobody seems to have any clue on who he is and where he came from, and his stoic raw masculinity offers a great contrast to our brass hero. At one point there were plans to have two campaigns with him starring in the other one, and it sure would have been interesting to see how they'd managed to pull that off.
That was too ambitious though, so the game's main draw will turn out to be its unique combat system that combines traditional Eastern style role-playing mechanics with strategy game like micromanagement. Does that sound difficult to understand? Well, I guess it depends on if you're accustomed to that kind of stuff.
Instead of one person per turn, you are controlling squads with each consisting of at maximum 5 units, who each give their abilities for use in battle, and the amount of squads and units you can have at a time increase the further you get in the game. Few of them come with the plot, but mostly they can be either be recruited from an army official, or if you want more elite individuals, from guilds and completing numerous side missions. And believe me, do as many of these as you can, because otherwise you're going to regret it later. The battles themselves may seem boring at the first glance. You just pick your actions and wait when everyone duke it out with flashy effects. However, you have occasionally a chance to press certain buttons that may either cause extra damage or allow you to counterattack, and paying attention to these may be crucial for turning the tide of battle.
But as much as I appreciate that interactivity jolt, it cannot hide the system's less smoother aspects, which are all caused by the game's inability to decide how much freedom does it want to give to its players.
While you can form the squads as you please, the list of actions they can choose during fights are limited to a handful for reasons I can't fathom, and they seem to change at random. It gets annoying when I figure out a tactic to win, but the game doesn't let me use it, which most of the time wasn't too bad, but then came this battle against an army led by some of the Conqueror's lackeys that I felt was won by pure luck. And speaking of tactics, there are several formations your units can be arranged in, and some of them work better against certain monster types, which would be useful if I could tell what type these monsters are, or if I could change these formations during battles in order to efficiently adapt to the new challenges. And speaking of challenges, this game requires heavy grinding, as it became painfully evident with this boss fittingly named Gates of Hell. Sure, I could go back roaming around the countryside and do more side missions, but the constant barrage of enemies doesn't sound like a quality time, as the battles do take long. Even then, I'm not sure if that could help, because I'd need to test through trial and error what units work best together. Frankly, I just don't care anymore, and keep in mind, I almost quit Betrayal at Krondor when it pulled this crap, yet I kept going. I could make it my own video game right now, but instead I'm recording footage for a video that probably takes at least 2 years before its viewer count reaches triple digits. I have watched significantly less movies because of this show, and I also have embedding applications for school, so I could do something else with my life than just sitting on my desk in my tiny shared apartment while all my other creative projects are launching in the depths of my laptop unfinished!
Whoa, that went that too real. The point is that I didn't finish the game. I stopped at about 20 hour mark, and story-wise, I reached the half point. I did check the rest of the cutscenes from YouTube, and overall, the story is serviceable. The Last Remnant has some interesting ideas, but in the end, it's just a high-budget learning process project.
The combat system either makes or breaks it, and for me, it had too many moving parts, artificial restrictions, and waiting periods to enjoy it. Presentation-wise, it's decent when it works properly. The story, while nothing spectacular, is competent, and I actually like some elements in it, like the mystery surrounding the Conqueror, and Russ's and David's well-written romance. And hey, the remaster exists, so maybe none of my criticisms about the game matters, so take this review with a grain of salt.
At the time of the release of this video, the remastered version hasn't still reached PC, but if the publisher people give it to the owners of the original port for free, or at least at significantly decreased price, I'm willing to give The Last Remnant another chance. Now, I really hope that the next game will be lighter, because the next 2 months are going to be really, really busy. Well, it is. And we'll have more than one game. Can you see it? Yep. Until then, thanks for your time!